angels, and we finished up the introductory study last week. So I'm going to go over here to slide number 17 as we get into a little more of the meat of the study. And again, this is not my it's not originated with me. This is not my material. It's something I picked out as kind of a guide to our study. We'll be looking at some more things, some more verses that will go along with our study. Let me change a couple things here. Should have had this done earlier. This is on another that I use as a Bible as we go through and look at some other passages. And chapter 33. Okay, so we've looked a lot, and one of the things that I want to impress on your mind is sometimes we have to just block out everything that people have told us about angels because it hasn't come from God's Word. It's just people surmising things, and sometimes people will even make things up. So we got to be careful. We've got to test all things, hold fast to that, which is good. And of course, we know that what God's Word tells us is good. Now, again, this study is not infallible. Nothing that a human being does is infallible. So not only will we look at this, we'll look at some other scriptures that help to identify things, thoughts within this to help us understand what angels, who they are, what they do, and how they interact with us today. So the best thing to do is start with the origin of angels, and we've touched briefly on different aspects of it, but just, you know, where do they come from? How did they come to be? Now, in Job chapter 38, verses 4 through 7, there are about four chapters here in the book of Job. If you've ever studied it or even just read through it, you know, God just gives some like rapid-fire questions to Job. And these are not questions that come to Job in a sense of somebody might be trying to trick somebody into something. These are questions that Job is supposed to be able to think about, but they tell us a lot about theology, God's theology, and how God deals with us. And, you know, why do bad things happen to good people? Well, the whole book of Job is about that. But when we begin to question God, we have to remember there's some things we just don't know. And we don't know it if God hasn't revealed it to us. That's the important thing. It's what God has revealed to us that we can glean an understanding of God's Word. So here, Job 38, verses 4 through 7. Where were you? Because Job is questioning God. Why did this happen to me? I've been a righteous person. I've offered sacrifices. I've raised my family right. I've done all of these things. Why does this happen to me? God says, where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Since he's questioning God, you know, there's sometimes we ask questions for information, right? And sometimes we ask questions to make other people look bad. Now, I don't know that Job was asking God questions about why this was happening to him to make God look bad, but yet it seems like in God's questioning Job, that God may have got that little bit of impression there. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Yeah, so, tell me, surely you know, he says, for who stretched the line upon it? On what were its bases sunk, or who laid its cornerstone? Verse 7 is what we're really looking at now. When the morning stars sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy. So where were you, Job, in the creation that you can say, you know, something's not right with what God has done? And we talked before how that God created everything and he looked at it and said, it's good. And when he finished, he said, it's very good. But we know now that the fallen world that we live in is not good. There's a lot of bad out there. There's a lot of evil. Yes, there's some good. It's still running on the principles that God set forth in the beginning. Something happened, and that's what we've talked about before. Did God create the bad stuff? No, he created everything good, but, and we'll talk later more about free will. When you give something free will, you better understand that it's probably going to turn against you at some point, or it has that capability to turn against you. So, when the morning stars sang together. Now, if you do cross-reference in Job, it might take you to Psalm chapter 19. Okay? The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows its handiwork, his handiwork. And that's from the King James Version. Some of the other newer versions will have a little different wording in there. And it'll take you to there that, you know, because of the testimony that's in the sky, this grand creation is testimony to the power of God and what God has done. But also think about it, there are times when angels are called stars in the scripture. And it's just a figurative language, like stars. And in fact, Lucifer is called a star, but also Jesus is called the morning star. Now, if you take this to be angels, when the angels sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy, when did that happen? Well, the context of verses 4 through 7 is in the creation, right? In the beginning, when God created the world, what happened? The angels were rejoicing. They said, wow, look at that. Look what God did. Because remember, angels cannot create. Angels don't procreate. Angels don't create. God does the creating. So what we look at here is, who are the sons of God? The sons of God shouted for joy when God laid the foundation of the earth. Is he talking about men, or is he talking about some other beings? Is he talking about angels? Well, he must be talking about angels. Why? Because Adam was not created until the sixth day. So Adam wasn't there before the world was created. He's a part of creation. So whoever these sons of God are existed before the creation of the universe, but say they're still not God because they're created beings. Why is this important? Well, it's important to understand that sometimes in Scripture, a term like sons of God can be used interchangeably for different beings, and unless you keep up with the context of it, you might get into a little problem in how things got to be so bad in this world. Now, I'll explain that more in just a little while. So who are these sons of God? They couldn't be men. Now, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Corinthians verse, what is it?
45.
For some reason, I'm still in Job. 1 Corinthians, chapter 15, and verse 45. Now, I'm using the English Standard Version here. Thus it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. And what Paul is doing there, he's comparing Adam as the father, so to speak, of the human race, the first man, with Jesus, who comes as the life-giving spirit. Jesus was who mankind, he's the prototype, he's the type of person that God was pulling all mankind toward. Jesus is what Adam should have been when it comes to obedience to God. But he failed miserably because through free will, he chose to sin against God. Genesis chapter 3 and verse 20 talks basically, or says basically the same thing. Let's run over there. The man called his wife's name Eve because she was the mother of all living. So on the sixth day of creation, then whatever little bit of time period there was before God took the rib from Adam and fashioned Eve, it's after the creation. So these sons of God must have been angels. And we could say angels, or we could say heavenly creatures, because again, what does the word angel mean? Messenger, right? So we're talking about beings that lived in the presence of God, lived in heaven. Now, does that mean that every time the phrase the sons of God appears in Scripture, that it means heavenly beings? And the answer is no, because aren't we told that if we obey the gospel, we become sons of God? Oh, 1 John. Let's just go, or I'm sorry, not 1 John, John. The Gospel according to John, chapter 1, and down about verse 10 or 11. Now, Jesus, who was and is the Word of God. Okay, John starts off, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. What happened to this God, the Word? He becomes God the Son by taking on human form. He becomes Jesus of Nazareth, born of Mary. Verse 10, starting, he was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. Talking about the Jews who were supposed to be looking for Messiah, the Christ. They were supposed to, but they didn't. But, verse 12, but to all the children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. It's not something that man does. It's something that God does when the person is born again. Notice, it's because of belief, but it's not belief only. All right? When a person believes, they then have the right to become a child of God. Well, how do you do that? Well, you go to John chapter 3. You have to be born of water and the Spirit. You have to be born again. So here's the children of God. But we are, as Christians, whether male or female, sons of God. Because we're adopted, so to speak, but born again into God's family. So, another place that's very important for us to understand this same, what do you want to call it, logic or procedure, Genesis chapter 6. Because people make a lot, there are commentators, and they believe it wholly, what they're talking about. They believe it, but yet they don't make that distinction. Listen to what's being said here. Verse 1, Genesis chapter 6. When man began to multiply on the face of the land, and daughters were born to them. To who? To men. So does that mean in the beginning, when Adam and Eve started having children, they had Cain and they had Abel, and then Seth replaces Abel, right? Does that mean there were no daughters? That was sometime later when all of a sudden daughters start showing up? No, because you go back in the scriptures, it said that Adam and Eve had sons and daughters, all right? So what's the distinction? How are we going to understand what's going on here? Now, Cain and Abel, were they the first? We don't know. It's kind of like there's an illusion in the scriptures that Cain came first, and then Abel, and then there's other sons and daughters who are born, and then after Cain and Abel grow up, Cain kills Abel. So what were the consequences of him killing Abel? Do you remember? He was cast out even from the community. Adam and Eve were cast out of, or driven out of the Garden of Eden. But Cain is driven out from the community. And what does he do when he's driven out? He starts a city, doesn't he? Was it Nod? Because that's one of his children. But he had a wife. And I think it even maybe says he had wives. But they are driven out, and there's a mark put on Cain. No man's supposed to kill him. God has judged him with this, casting him away from that community. So what then would be the two communities, and especially when then you have Seth being born to replace Abel? It seems like there are two groups of people then on the earth. There are the people who worship and serve God like Abel did and was killed, and you got a group much like Cain, who disobeyed God and were in rebellion. If we were looking at it today with what the scripture says, we'd call one group the sons of God and the children of God, and the other group the children of the devil. See what I'm talking about? So, when man began to multiply on the face of the land, and daughters were born to them, yeah, there were daughters born all along, but there comes a time, okay, right up at the time of Noah. Remember, Noah was a descendant of which son? Seth. He was a descendant of Seth. So it seems like the Sethites, and that's the lineage that you have brought down. You have Cain's lineage, right? And you have Tubal-Cain, and you got a bunch of others, and they do a bunch of stuff. Then you have Seth's lineage. Now in Seth's lineage, you have such people as Methuselah and Enoch. What was Noah's father's name?
Lamech.
Okay. Those are all descendants of Seth coming down this lineage of people. Now what's so noteworthy about Methuselah?
His age.
He was a good man. Why did he live so long?
God had a purpose for him.
God had a purpose for him, that he was a man who served God and walked with God. Enoch. What do we remember about him?
Taken before the flood.
Why was he taken?
So he didn't have to suffer death.
Yeah, but why? What was the motivating factors?
His testimony about God.
Okay, but he walked with God. Okay, Lamech, basically the same way. Now, if you go back and you look at the dates, the dating, you know, after so many years, this person had this son and this son, you know, on down through. Noah was 600 years old when God told him to build an ark. Right? If you look at the ages of Methuselah and Lamech, because Enoch was taken, you find that they died shortly before the flood. God takes Enoch because, you know, he doesn't have to die, but also, in a sense, Methuselah and Lamech die. They don't have to suffer the consequences of the flood. So it seems like out of this whole group of people, it comes down to here's the last hope. The last great hope. Because what's happened to the rest of this family? All right? You know, it starts here. We'll just go with Seth. Well, Seth's going to have children, and they're going to have children. You know how that goes, right? The family tree. But it seems like it's coming down to this, where there's only one person that God says, Noah found grace. God's word. Noah found grace in the sight of God. He wasn't a perfect man, but at least he was doing what God said needed to be done. So here, you've got, and this is my reasoning on this, here you've got the sons of God in a, there you got that triangle, right? Family tree. But only one of them's really faithful to God. What happened? What happened that they become like Cain's descendants? This huge amount of people who are in rebellion to God. Well, again, look at Genesis chapter 6, verse 1. When man began to multiply on the face of the earth, or the face of the land, and daughters were born to them, who's that talking about? Is that Seth's people, or is that Cain's people? It doesn't say, but look at the next verse then. The sons of God saw that the daughters of man were attractive. It's not that they're converting them. Who's converting who here? They're taking.
They're converting to do it.
Yeah, they're taking wives, and notice what it says. They took as their wives any they chose. Any. So there must have been a restriction there where God had told the Sethites, hey, don't marry Cain's descendants. Stay, no intermarriage with them. Alright? Now, please understand, that doesn't count today. Why doesn't it count today? Because all those people were destroyed in the flood. Right? Okay. So, don't intermarry. Don't marry from this group of people. It's going to destroy you. But it says later, look, Then the Lord said, My spirit shall not abide in man forever, for he is flesh, his day shall be 120 years. The Nephilim were on the face of the earth in those days, and also afterward, when the sons of God came into the daughters of man, and they bore children to them. These were mighty men who were of old, the men of renown. Now, and that's where they joke, these people who take that the sons of God were angels, or even demons, that's where they jump. See, that there was a superhuman race that developed because of this. And it's not. It's, if you go back and you look at history, there were people who became rulers, even almost what we call emperors later on, who ruled over large groups of people. And that's, I believe, that's what it's talking about. Have you ever heard the Code of Hammurabi? Okay. Again, that's in that time frame, probably before the flood. You've got people who, it doesn't necessarily mean they had to be giants, like 9 foot, 10 foot tall. It means they were leaders, so to speak, powerful people, and they would take, later on, you have the same thing happening with rulers who would take wives, and, oh, what, over time already. But, just finish this up, they would take wives, and what happens if one man takes, like Solomon, what did he have, 700 wives, 300 concubines? What happens if he takes all those wives and there he is? What happens?
Kids. A lot of kids.
A lot of kids, but something else happens. What's happening in China today?
I think there'd be a lot of division. A lot of
Yeah, it's starting to arise there. What's happening in China now? Remember what happened. The government ruled you can only have one child. So what happened when they found out that the mother was either having or had a female child?
They get rid of them.
They'd either abort the child or, when the child is born, they kill it. Now they've got a glut of males who have no wives.
But we're given.
See what's happening in the world today? You see how things are changing, the face of things? So that's part of what's going on here, this attitude, because at first God said, one man, one wife. Now it was a descendant of Cain, a man whose name is also Lamech, who took two wives. And in the English language, it comes out, they're Ada and Zillah. And somebody said, yeah, see, he took wives from A to Z. You know, but all he said, I can do this. You know, and look at his attitude, go back and read the account of it, his attitude toward God. And he killed a young man, you know, okay, if Cain is to be avenged seven times, but go back and read it if you have the correct account. Anyway, so, any questions? Quick question. Maybe you want to save one for next week. Yeah, we're about 5 minutes after 11, so we will get going here. A little bit more about the original meaning. Am I making it, am I expressing, am I communicating well enough? And again, if there's questions, ask me anytime. All right. Class dismissed. Thank you.